because any sequence is really like a vector in an infinite dimensional space, and the infinity of that dimension is the infinity of the integers. You can think of each sample of the sequence as a coordinate of that so-called vector. So, a sequence is like a vector in a countably infinite, this is, you know, when we say in a countably infinite dimensional space, whose orthonormal basis is essentially the set of all unit impulse sequences. Put a unit impulse at every integer location, and each of these gives you a separate perpendicular vector. This is a generalization from what we have in this five-dimensional space here. You see, you can think that if you were to generalize this here to in five-dimensional space, of course, you are putting the ones respectively at the locations 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. But you can keep generalizing this. You can put this at each integer location, and each of them gives you a new perpendicular vector. And that's how you have an orthonormal basis for the space of sequences. And of course, we know very easily how we can express any sequence in terms of this perpendicular basis. That we've already done when we were trying to derive the principle of convolution. So we saw that any sequence, any vector or sequence xn can be expressed in terms of these. That's very easy. Xn is summation k going from minus to plus infinity xk delta n minus k. You know, in signal processing, it's very interesting, like in poetry. The same lines can have many meanings. The same equation can assume many meanings in signal processing and communication, and one must learn to appreciate that. So, this very equation here had a different meaning when we talked about convolution. There we said that, you know, you are thinking of it, of course, in a way it had a, you know, there is a relationship between that meaning and this, but still, there you were trying to express all sequences in terms of the unit impulse. Now, here what you are trying to do is to show that you have an orthonormal basis, and in fact, we will show in a moment that it is orthonormal, and that the orthonormal basis can allow you to expand any vector in terms of it. So, it is the same, you know, the one equation can have several meanings or several different interpretations or several nuances of interpretation, and one must learn to appreciate that as we go along. Anyway, so coming back to this, it is very clear that we can express xn in terms of this orthonormal basis, but what we now need to see is why are we calling it orthonormal. So, we need to talk about a dot product. You see, the dot product between two sequences is, as we generalize from finite dimensional spaces, the dot product will be essentially a sum over all the coordinates. You see, each k is a coordinate now. Each location is a coordinate. x1n, x1k, x2k, and for the moment, let us assume real sequence. x1, x2, at the moment, we are assuming real sequences, and we are assuming the coordinates are real. So, this is essentially a generalization from what we did in finite dimensional spaces. We took the product of corresponding coordinates and we added up over all the coordinates. But now, we need to ask whether this definition is acceptable when the sequences are complex. So, for that, we need to ask what more do we want from a dot product. Before we do that, since we are generalizing the idea of a dot product, we would like to use a slightly more general notation for dot product. So, the dot product is also more generally called the inner product. And it's denoted by the inner product of x1, x2, like this, with triangular brackets. Now, you see, if you take the dot product of x with x, what do you get? In conventional vector algebra, we get the magnitude square of the vector. And here, we'd like to use the notation norm. So, instead of saying magnitude for a vector in general, for this generalized class of vectors, we call it the norm. In fact, we call it the 2 norm. So, don't worry too much about this lower 2, but the upper 2 is essentially a squared. This is what is called the L2 norm. This is a technicality, let's not worry too much about it, but let's write it down for completeness. I mean, you could have other numbers here also. However, in our discussion in this course, we shall not keep writing this subscript 2 after this. We shall understand that it is the 2 norm. Now, you see, one thing, this norm is the generalization of the idea of magnitude. So, instead of using the word magnitude for this generalized class of vectors, we call it the norm. It's the same idea. But you see, what do we want of a norm? We definitely want that a norm or a norm squared be non-negative. In fact, we want the norm to be not only non-negative, if the vector is 0 only, then we would allow it to be 0. If there is a non-zero vector, we definitely do not expect that it should have a 0 magnitude. Okay? So, we want the dot product of x with x to be greater than or equal to 0, and we want dot product of x with x to be equal to 0 if and only if the vector x is itself 0, which means xn is equal to 0 for all n. Is that correct? But you see, if we take the definition of the dot product or the inner product that we just used a few minutes ago, if we take the dot product or the inner product of x1, x2 to be summation k over all the integers x1k, x2k for complex x1, x2 as well. If we do this, then what are we going to land up with? We are going to land up in the troublesome situation that the inner product of x with x is simply summation k going from minus to plus infinity x squared n, but x squared n when xn is complex could be complex, and summation over k x squared, of course this should be k, sorry, so summation over k x squared need not be 0, need not be non-negative. In fact, it can be complex in general, and we definitely do not want that. We want it to be a magnitude squared. So, that can only be non-negative, and it should be 0 only if x itself is 0. Is that correct? Now, you see, how do we then correct the situation? It's very clear that we want each of these terms in the summation to contribute a non-negative quantity. And that can be done only if you have a modulus in each of the terms. And that modulus can appear only if you bring in a complex conjugate. And therefore, we redefine the dot product in general for complex x1, x2. We need to redefine the dot product of x1 with x2 to be summation k going from minus to plus infinity x1 k x2 k complex conjugate. No doubt this makes no difference for real x1 x2 at all. The definition for real x1 x2 is as it is. Is that clear? Yes. You see, now it's very clear. Now, of course, once we've done this, we've taken care of the problem. So now we have the inner product of x with x is equal to summation k going from minus to plus infinity mod xk square. It is xk complex conjugate, which is summation on k mod xk squared. This is of course greater than or equal to 0. It is 0 only if, in fact, if and only if xk is equal to 0 for all k. Unless each of those terms is 0, this cannot sum to 0, because each term there is non-negative. And therefore, we have achieved what we want out of the dot product. We have been able to redefine the dot product in such a way that it takes care of this use of the dot product for calculating the magnitude squared of a vector.